We've got our first 2024 NFL regular season game in the books. We're going to hit on that a little bit. Obviously involved AFC stalwarts, the Baltimore Ravens, Kansas City Chiefs. Some Browns news to start it off. We'll talk about it all. Your latest Locked On Browns starts now.
You are Locked On Browns, your daily Cleveland Browns podcast. Part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day.
Welcome back, my friends, to the show that never ends, your daily delivery of all things Dog Pound, LGB on the LOB, the Locked On Browns podcast, brought to you by the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day. I am your host, Jeff Lloyd. We appreciate everybody who makes Locked On Browns their first listen every single day. Everyday crowd, the numbers keep growing. Do not miss out. Subscribe to the Locked On YouTube channel. Become an everydayer. The show is always available. It is always free wherever you get your podcasts. This episode is brought to you by Prize Picks, the easiest and most exciting way to play daily fantasy sports. Go to prizepicks.com/LockedOnNFL and use code all lowercase LockedOnNFL to win $50 instantly when you play $5. You don't even need to win to receive the $50 bonus. Prize Picks. Run your game. How is everybody doing? We are joined by the OBR's Pete Smith. Still waiting for the Browns to add a 53rd guy to the roster after the move yesterday, waiving third-year wide receiver David Bell. We will see the way it works. There's a lot of people painting the picture that this was an easier avenue for the Browns to retain David Bell to the practice squad. I am not so sure. But Pete is here. Pete, first off, the move itself, I mean, there was some oddity to it. But, you know, when you do read between the lines with some other people as far as trying to get a player back and kind of sneaking him through the system late in the week on a Thursday is kind of the way you would go about it.
Well, that, and I don't think they're trying to sneak him to the practice squad. I think if they're going to get him back, it's going to be back to the active roster after, you know, whatever they need to occupy that roster spot with. I mean, I don't see a world where he could just sit on the practice squad. You're hoping that you can pull this off, get him right back up, and be able to operate normally.
No doubt. Now, Pete, when you make a move, obviously it's done with the, you know, thought process that it's going to have to be a corresponding move. We already know from the 53 that Jedrick Wills most likely is not going to be playing on Sunday, which means Jedrick Wills, you know, will not be active, which means somebody will come up, Jermaine Urfidy, Lorenzo Thompson, one of those two guys. But there is the, you know, for me, one of the things is, you know, I'm a little nervous with Jack Conklin, and maybe he is on the J.C. Treader plan where, you know what, we'll get you right Friday and then we'll play it out. But maybe it's not one tackle or it's two, and I know I bantied about it yesterday. You just mentioned to me before we hit the record button, and I don't know how much of a factor it's going to be necessarily if you see last night's game, but, you know, none of the Browns specialists right now, it looks like there would be your number one return option.
Well, I mean, the Jack Conklin piece is interesting just because when you listen to him talk, he sounds like he's ready to go. But how they're handling him suggests they're at least not, you know, they're holding him back a little bit. So it's a question of, you know, if it's just a strategy on their part that they feel like there's no sense in doing it full on practice or whatever. But he keeps talking about how he feels better every day. As far as the special teams thing, you know, they've got a whole lot of options for that in terms of returners and all that. You know, the last night's the Ravens Chiefs game wasn't exactly a phenomenal debut for the new kickoff. But I mean, there's talk that Elijah Moore could be utilized as a punt returner. There's talk that, you know, they've used Deontay Foreman. Jerome Ford certainly could be a kick returner. They've got a lot of options. I'm just not, you know, if I'm any team, I'm just kicking it out the back of the end zone. So I'm very curious to see if Dallas even bothers with it.
And look, you can play that game early in the season while you're learning the way this all works. And then as the weather starts to become a factor, you know, you maybe don't necessarily have the ability to put it in the back of the end zone each and every week. You know, defense, you know, you look like you're set there. You know, you have your 11 DBs on the roster, most likely probably going to suit up 10, probably going to sit maybe a linebacker. Who knows if, you know, Bukie Watson is actually even ready to go. You know, some of these guys are just returning to practice. defensive line. You're currently rostering 9. Maybe somebody gets called up there. Is, you know, the practice squad, is it going to be of any consequence necessarily this week other than maybe an offensive tackle elevation and maybe somebody for return duties?
It's hard to say because the Browns are really aggressive with their use of the practice squad. Like they could easily, I mean, they've got 3 gunners on that list. So it
3 corners. Shock
me if they bring either Hardy or Mike Ford up. So that becomes an easy one, but yeah, I mean, offensive tackle is the thing that sort of stands out to you, or just additional offensive line help. Other than that, I mean, you've got more than enough corners, safeties. It's possible that they bring up another running back, I guess. But overall, I think it's special teams and offensive line.
It's a shame John Kelly didn't make it, because there he was on Thursday Night Football. But this may have been the year for John Kelly to actually get a little regular season run. You hear from Deshaun, you hear from the wide receivers coach, you hear from the offensive coordinator. A little bit different. Ken Dorsey's opting to be on the sidelines. We'll see how long that goes on. Now, Pete, look, you've coached a long time. You know, what would be the benefit necessarily from having your offensive coordinator on the sideline as opposed to up in the booth?
Well, I mean, I think it's all about Deshaun Watson, being able to talk to him, being able to regularly communicate with him as opposed to sort of getting on the phones. And the sense I get is, based on this, they must really like what I presume is a combination of Chad O'Shea and potentially some of the other guys that they have up there, including they have a couple of guys that like are specifically doing like analytics and data and stuff. That they may like the eyes in the sky better. That Chad O'Shea's been there the whole time. I'm presuming he's a big part of it. So if they're comfortable with what he's relaying down to the field and being that point man, then you're going to get just Ken Dorsey continuously being able to talk to Deshaun Watson, since Kevin Stefanski is going to obviously be busy. You know, for all the, you know, all these people who are mad about him calling plays, he's going to be managing the game. So now you have Ken Dorsey who can constantly be talking to Deshaun Watson, talking about what he's seeing, you know, and not just him. Obviously, he's being the quasi offensive coordinator. He has the ability to talk to everybody on the offense. So having that communication element is I guess beneficial from that sense as well.
I mean, the first thing that comes to mind me is, you know, when you're breaking out the iPads or whatever tablet device they're going to use, is you're getting, you know, 4 eyes on the same screen as opposed to, you know, right there, you know, one-on-one, as opposed to, you know, through the headset, whatever type of communication there. And look, it'll be one of these things. If it works, there's going to be no reason to change it. Look, it's all about getting 4 to play to the abilities that 4 displayed in Houston and getting him to take it up even more than a notch. You know, for most of us, we've been kind of beneficial and supportive of the play that Watson has had in the limited time he's been out there. But, you know, there is the possibility for more, no question about it. We'll talk some Cowboys, Browns, Sunday, 4:25. The OBR's Pete Smith is here. Nobody go anywhere. When you are hiring for your small business, you want to find quality professionals that are right for the role. That's why you have to check out LinkedIn Jobs. LinkedIn Jobs has the tools to help find the right professionals for your team faster and for free. LinkedIn isn't just a job board. LinkedIn helps you hire professionals you can't find anywhere else. Even those who aren't actively searching for a new job, but might be open to the perfect role. In a given month, over 70% of LinkedIn users don't visit other leading job sites. So if you're not looking on LinkedIn, you're looking in the wrong place, or most likely you're not even looking at all. On LinkedIn, 86% of small businesses get a qualified candidate within 24 hours. Hire professionals like a professional on LinkedIn. Post your job for free at linkedin.com/lockedonNFL. That is linkedin.com/lockedonNFL to post your job for free. Terms and conditions apply. Your latest Locked On Browns continues. I am your host, Jeff Lloyd. We appreciate you all for making the show your first listen every day. Make sure you become an everydayer subscriber to Locked On Browns YouTube channel. And, of course, the show is always available, always free, wherever you get your podcasts. The anticipation is growing, and I think for everybody, you know, if you're not a fan of the Ravens or the Chiefs, but you get that first taste of NFL regular season action, you are now ready to go. So the anticipation of having to waiting to Sunday is probably a little difficult, but here we are. Pete, it's going to be interesting. Now, you look at the Dallas Cowboys, and one of the first things that stands out to me, and, you know, for years, where we were so critical of the Browns' defensive line play, where it was Myles Garrett and the Garrett ears, essentially. But now, this is a revamped unit over the last couple of years. It has now become a plus positional group and unit, I should say groups and units, for the Browns. Dallas is going to be starting a rookie left tackle who was a career right tackle. We all kind of know how that goes. Not saying it's not going to work out for Tyler Guyton, but certainly something to consider. Rookie center as well. Rookie corner as well. Your number one corner is coming off of an ACL injury. There are a lot of questions for the Dallas Cowboys here, Pete, in some seriously important positions.
Well, look, I think the Dallas Cowboys offensive line is going to be pretty good. They've got two really good guards. Tyler Smith was phenomenal last year. Zach Martin is still a very, very good pro. And then Terrence Steele is sort of in a similar boat as all the Browns offensive tackles. Injury riddle, you know, sort of diminished year last year. They're expecting to be good. And then you've got two rookies. Tyler Guyton, who was expected to be a project, is seemingly ahead of schedule and has done really well. But his first game is against Myles Garrett. And then there's center Cooper Beebe, who has never played center in an actual game. Now, he's the second the Cowboys drafted him. He's a former tackle, then guard at Kansas State. He's been doing nothing but center, and they like him, but he's a rookie there too. So, obviously, I think the so much of the attention is going to be paid to the tackles, and Myles Garrett and Za'Darius Smith, which as they should be. But I think the Browns have a real opportunity, given the less than stellar crew of running backs the Cowboys have between Ezekiel Elliott, Rico Dowdell, and presumably Dalvin Cook will be activated. If Dalvin Tomlinson, which will be interesting to monitor how many snaps he's able to play coming off this knee scope, Shelby Harris, and those guys can really stop the run and consistently force Dak Prescott into having to carry the offense, an offense that will be relying on CeeDee Lamb, who hasn't been there basically all offseason. I mean, you know, there are people speculating that the Cowboys should not have him play all the reps because, you know, risking a hamstring injury, something like that, which I don't think the Browns would be upset about. But if that's the case, then you know, CeeDee Lamb is phenomenal. You've got to take care of him. They've got Jake Ferguson, who's a fine tight end. And then it's Brandon Cooks and Jalen Tolbert. So if you can force them to be one dimensional in that regard, it gives the Browns a massive advantage. They want to rush the passer anyway. So that really plays into their hands. I think the other side of the ball is also interesting in that regard because you got Micah Parsons and DeMarcus Lawrence, arguably the best defensive end tandem in the league. And the Browns obviously have questions at their tackle spots. But the interior, it's Osa Odighizuwa, who's a very fine player, but he's built basically just like Maurice Hurst or Mike Hall. And he's good at being a pass rusher. He's not a great run defender. And obviously, if you can get a body on him, you're going to have a significant advantage because he's about 280 pounds. Other than him, they just signed Linval Joseph off the street, who's about to be 36, was awful last year. They traded for nose tackle from the Bills, who stunk last year. And they've got Mozzie Smith, who stunk as a rookie last year, and they obviously need him to be a lot better. And granted, they have a lot of size. These are big people. But if the Browns, you know, if Joel Bitonio is back to being Joel Bitonio, if Wyatt Teller can be the player they need him to be, and if Ethan Posick can, his game just elevates by virtue of having two competent guards around him, the Browns have an opportunity to get a big push up the middle and just be able to help their offense. But they don't need to have a great rushing attack, though that would be helpful. If Jerome Ford and Deontay Foreman can just be effective and keep the Cowboys guessing and put the Browns consistently in like second and six, third and four, where you at least keep the possibility open that you could still hand the ball off, it's going to help mitigate some of that pass rush. And if Jack Conklin is going at left tackle, he's been a good run blocker, so that gives you a slight plus on that side. He's a better run blocker than Jedrick Wills was. You know, DeJuan Jones has his own questions, but for this type of matchup, all you're worried about is pass protection. So beyond that, it's I think for both quarterbacks in this game, it's get the ball out of your hands. I don't think you can make the mistake of just trying to hold onto the ball and trying to extend plays too much. You got to be really smart picking your spots, because this game could easily hinge on a sack, fumble type situation, or, you know, a big play in backfield. Beyond all the injury concerns that Browns fans have with, is Deshaun Watson going to hold up? I just think, look at it as, you've got to stay ahead of the sticks, and you can't afford to get those negative plays. So, like, Deshaun Watson's been talking about this all offseason, talking about, you know, seeing the Ravens game and what was effective, which was just get the ball to your guys and trust them. He needs to do that. And if he can do that and they can run a just a modestly effective game inside, I think the Browns are going to be able to have an advantage.
One of the things, and now when you bring up Micah Parsons, is you know, like, he can line up everywhere. He can do a lot of what Myles Garrett does, but you have to think you're probably not going to waste a lot of time, you know, threatening the interior, you know, gaps, because you do have Teller there, you do have Posick there, you do have Betonio there. You probably want Micah Parsons to attack from the outside. It's not certainly a question. You want to, you know, if you're the Cowboys, you want to see what these tackles have. Obviously, the main focus here should probably be CeeDee Lamb, and what we'll see how much he plays. And I got to be honest with you, I think he's going to play almost, you know, probably the full lion's share. I would not be surprised. It's just the type of player CeeDee is. But there's a lot of people who just want to talk about the Denzel Ward CeeDee Lamb matchup. But Pete, he lines up everywhere. And, you know, he will line up on the left, he will line up on the right, he will line up on the slot, which probably, you know, for most teams defending him, it's not the best thing in the world. But for the Browns, when you have this combination of Greg Newsome on the inside, you have Denzel on the outside, and certainly Martin Emerson on the outside, you know, you want to basically have, because you want to know what, these guys can kind of go even full bore and harass the, you know, living daylights out of them. But there might be reps where you're, you know, for Emerson, for Ward, for Newsome, where you're not threatened or have, you know, in the same scenario where it's CeeDee Lamb. So when these guys get their opportunities at CD, you want to give it just as good as you're going to get it.
Well, I'm wondering if they just don't have Martin Emerson just follow him around the whole game and have help, because CeeDee Lamb is not small. He's also fearless. He's 6'2", 200 and some pounds. You know, I'm not going to say don't have Denzel Ward cover him. I'm just wondering if, because of Greg Newsome's ability to line up inside and outside, if that doesn't give you the freedom to say, hey, Emerson, just press the hell out of him off the line of scrimmage, and we're going to give you help behind to always sort of give him something. And meanwhile, if it's Brandon Cooks, Denzel Ward, just erase him. And then Greg Newsome, take out Jalen Tolbert, and most likely Grant Delpa, you're going to be responsible for Jake Ferguson, and just lock it down that way. If they can do that, great. But that will definitely be something to monitor. My guess is the Browns will throw different looks at CeeDee Lamb just to try to mix it up and not give him the same thing. But, like, I would have no problem just saying, Martin Emerson, he's getting hit off the line every play. Or if they want to motion him around, great. But, you know, that would be the part where you'd have to sort of adjust your situation. But CeeDee Lamb's the one guy you go into this game saying he cannot beat us. Cannot beat us. And if you do that, then if that doesn't happen, I have a difficult time seeing how the Cowboys get a lot of points. Now, if they could win a rock fight if the Browns offense struggles, but if they need to score 28 points, for example, I don't see how they do it without CeeDee Lamb being great.
And, you know, this is where the defense is built. It is now year two under Jim Schwartz. You're basically returning almost every pivotal player that was a part of the 2023 defense. Look, the expectation is this defense should be just as good, if not better, in 2024. A lot of experience, a lot more comfortable with everybody within the roles they are playing now. And Jim Schwartz has the guys that he feels fit his defense. Thursday Night Football, it was a classic. An inch proved to be the difference, but we got some thoughts on the Ravens, Chiefs. Obviously, it's relative as everybody's battling in the AFC. We're going to continue on here on your latest Locked On Browns. Prize Picks is America's number one daily fantasy sports app with over 5 million active members. Prize Picks is the easiest, most exciting way to play daily fantasy sports. Unlike other apps on Prize Picks, it's just you against the numbers. All you do is pick more or less than on a 2-6 player stat projection lineup and watch your winnings roll in. One Caleb Williams passing yard gets you one win on Prize Picks every week in September. That's right. Only 1 yard gets you an automatic win every football weekend in September. 4 weeks of free W's Do not be a fool. Cash in on it on Prize Picks because it's gone once September ends. We won a bunch of money last year, as you all know, with the likes of Amari Cooper, with the likes of Jerome Ford, with the likes of David Njoku. Tune in later today for your official pregame show. We will give you your Cleveland Browns Prize Picks lineup for week one. Download the Prize Picks app today and use code LOCKEDONNFL and get $50 off instantly when you play $5. That's code LOCKEDONNFL on Prize Picks to get $50 instantly when you play $5. You don't even need to win to receive the $50 bonus. It's guaranteed. Prize Picks, run your game. Your latest LOB continues. Your host, Jeff Lloyd. Appreciate you all for making the show your first listen. If you're not part of the everyday crowd by now, make a new plan, stand, subscribe to Locked On Browns YouTube channel. Correct that immediately. This show is always available. It is always free wherever you get your podcasts. The OBR's Pete Smith is in the house. Pete, if you're going to start the season, primetime game, that's something you want. An absolute banger. 27-20 Chiefs win over the Baltimore Ravens. Game decided last play of the game. Looked like Isaiah Likely, once a Pete Smith draft darling, by the way, was about to haul in his 10th catch for probably almost 120-something yards, two touchdowns, but by the hair of a chinny chin chin, was out of bounds. Game over. Kansas City wins. I'm going to go to the Chiefs first, Pete. I just don't know how the rest of the league just kind of lets these things fall into the Kansas City Chiefs' lap. And look, the signing of Hollywood Brown, you understood it. I don't know if we'll ever see Hollywood Brown actually play for the Chiefs. Everything they needed, everything they wanted, because other guys have grown. Rasheed Rice, whatever you think, off the field, on the field, the guy's ability is fantastic. And you don't need Xavier Worthy to beat Tyreek Hill. You got just enough yesterday for him to be a difference maker. But the Chiefs, they do it so many different ways. Last year didn't have this type of ability. This year they do. And they just continue to roll on week after week, year after year.
The Chiefs were good. Xavier Worthy's fine. It's like the end around is very impressive. Like the other touchdown was wide open. A lineman could have run that and caught that and been open, given the fact that Marlon Humphrey sat in like a cover two look and seemed to think he was getting help that never arrived. Look, the Chiefs are really good. They understand how they win. They did it largely without Travis Kelce, as they're going to have to do. And obviously the biggest thing sort of hanging out there beyond getting Hollywood Brown back is, when is Rashee Rice's situation going to hit? Because it's one, it's a felony. Two, it's really hard to argue he didn't do it. And three, like, you know, there's all this talk about, well, you know, they're fortunate that he wasn't put on the commissioner's exempt list or anything like now. Well, that's fine now, but if it's in December or January, that's going to be a big problem for them. So, look, the Chiefs' offensive line, interior offensive line, is outstanding. They create a lot of running room. Isaiah Pacheco is very good. But they do have some real questions on defense. Chris Jones is phenomenal. They've got some talent up front. Their linebackers are very good. Secondary left a lot of plays out there. The Ravens couldn't take advantage. And it stood out on the last three plays of the game. Lamar Jackson misses two wide open passes in the end zone and hit connects on the third, and he's a toe out of bounds. But like two of those, there was nobody in anywhere near those guys. So look, you lose Legarius Sneed in the offseason. They have, don't get me wrong, they have talent, but they have some questions to answer. And obviously, you know, the old adage is, you make your biggest improvement from week one to week two. So if the Chiefs are going to get better, great. I also think some of this comes down to the deficiencies the Ravens have, and they're another team where I think they will get better as the year rolls on. But replacing three starters was a nightmare. And Ronnie Stanley is not good, like, right now. And I forget the penalty part. Like, I'm not worried about that, but, like, he had real problems in protection. Like, Tyler Linderbaum's great. But, like, Roger Rosengarten didn't look ready to go. You know, they had Macari getting beat at points. Daniel Falale, I don't think that's working real well right this second. So, like, Derrick Henry could not get going. They just got beat off the line of scrimmage, and they were able to get Derrick Henry before he was able to get, you know, his wheels really turning, and you found yourself in a familiar spot. Lamar Jackson has to do the whole thing, and he's great, and he's phenomenal, and he can do all this stuff. But it's week one. He's got 16 more of these, and they expect to play at least three more after that. So they need these other things to work out for them real fast. Isaiah Likely was phenomenal. They obviously want to get more out of Mark Andrews. I clearly love what they have in Zay Flowers. Rashad Bateman made a couple plays, but they need more out of all these other guys. Like, you know, through a large portion of that game, Justice Hill was their leading receiver. That is not how they want to operate. So they've got some real issues to correct, and they have the same problem on defense. Like, they left a bunch of plays wide open. Kyle Hamilton is a superstar. I don't know if he was ever a factor in that game. They managed to remove him from the game in terms of his impact overall. Their corners didn't look very good. Obviously, they were able to cause problems for the Ravens in the middle of the field with Rashee Rice and doing some of those other things. And Roquan Smith's a great linebacker. They need more out of the other linebackers. But, like, the edge question remains. Jadeveon Clowney had a great year last year. Kyle Van Noy was good last year and then was questionable with injury. I'm assuming he will be fine. Their defense
actually broke an orbital bone.
Oh, okay. Well, then, yeah, that's not good. They have real questions. Like, David Ojabo, you saw a little bit. Oway, they want him to take another step, but they – like, that's a question mark for them. The spine of that defense is phenomenal, but they have questions elsewhere. And again, I'm going to keep stressing this. I think the Ravens will get better over the course of the season. It's just a question of how long will it take? You know, can they get through it without piling up losses? And what's the ceiling on their improvement? Like, those are all real questions, because where the Ravens are good, they are outstanding. Where the Ravens are bad, they are pretty bad right this second.
And one of the biggest takeaways for me, though, is you thought for all these years you're trying to get Lamar to not have to do that all the time. And you know, and how many times did we hear last night, oh, well, he dropped 12 pounds. Well, if he's got three new starters on his offensive line and he dropped 12 pounds, I'm not necessarily sure that's the best thing for him. And the other thing is, he was kind of initiating contact yesterday, which seems kind of absurd to do with your quarterback. I understand you got a couple extra days because it's Thursday night and you're not kicking off again for 9-10 days. I get all that. But, you know, like you said, there's still 16 more. And then whatever you think January is going to bring you. And we know Lamar, you know, has had times in his NFL career trying to string all of them together. He always seems to find his way back. That's fine. But they may not, with starting three new offensive linemen, with working in so much newness on defense, they might not have that type of, you know, luxury this year where they can kind of get a lead, Lamar can kind of get rested and, you know, recharge for the run. They might not have that luxury this season. We hit on a ton. Obviously, David Bell released, still waiting for a corresponding move, nothing from that. It does appear, sadly, that maybe Deshaun Watson is speaking that his father may have passed away. So, obviously, prayers to, you know, Deshaun Watson and his family for all that's going on there. We talked Browns, Cowboys. We certainly talked what was a thriller on Thursday Night Football. Come back later in the day. You will catch the final official pregame show for week one with all that's going on as far as injuries. We would like a little bit more info before I go ahead and go out on a limb and give you guys all my thoughts on what should be a spectacular home opener for 425 Sunday in Cleveland. He is Pete Smith from the OBR. Make sure you check out everything the crew's doing over there. Just keep adding people, putting out even more and more content. Fantastic stuff. Make sure you're following @_Pete_Smith_. Myself, Jeff Lloyd, I appreciate you all for making the show your first listen. Everyday crowd, you guys are a bunch of filthy animals, but you're my filthy animals. I suggest everybody become an everydayer, subscribe to Locked On Browns YouTube channel. The show is always available. It is always free wherever you get your podcasts. This has been your daily delivery of all things Dog Pound, LGB on ELOB. Let's go, Browns.